If you need to read data from an EEPROM or write data to an EEPROM, but don't have a whole lot of money to spend on a fancy writing device, this might be your trick. I picked this up from eBay for about 10 bucks and didn't come with any software. I had to go and download it from various websites, but it did the trick for me. What I want to cover in the next few minutes is how to install these things and get them up and running. Once you get your device unboxed, you can plug it right into your USB. You can even do this before you get the software or the drivers installed. What I'm going to cover in this demo here is basically how to get the drivers and install them and some basic programming with this device here. Now that we have the EEPROM reader-writer device plugged into a USB port, we can install some software and some drivers. I don't recommend putting your EEPROM chip in just yet because you may not know how to put it in with the correct orientation. Alright, so you're going to need to have a couple of files. You're going to need the software itself and some actual drivers. I had to do a bunch of Google searches to figure out what software I needed and where to get the software. There's two things that you're going to need. You're going to need to have the software itself, and that's this 224xx25xx zip file, and there's a couple sources here, and I will try to put these in a nice convenient link in this YouTube video here. Both of these seem to have the exact same content on here, and they worked. I've actually downloaded software from many sites, but these two seem to be the cleanest and easiest to get to. The second file that you're going to need is the actual driver itself. I have no idea why they don't put the drivers in the actual software folder. Maybe it's because of different operating systems, stuff like that, but this ch341par.zip file contains the actual drivers itself. If you have a different operating system or a different computer configuration, this link here, this ftdichip.com, they seem to have a good collection of drivers, even manuals, or not manuals, but some basic documentation in a PDF format that helps you get your drivers and stuff like that set up. I didn't have to follow that, but those documents did sort of point me in the right direction on how to get some of this software up and running. So let's do the first thing. I've created a folder here called EEPROM Demo, but you can put this wherever you want. You're gonna have to put all of your software in the same folder. So let's go ahead and open up our 24xx25xx zip file, extract everything to this folder, and then let's do that same process to this ch341par.zip file, and it expands and brings in all of that content there. So we have a whole bunch of files, system files, INF files, sys files, English INI file, driver files, all that kind of good stuff here. So let me just run the software here, the ch341a.exe. Now I do have my chip plugged in, I have my the device reader plugged into a USB port, but the chip is not plugged in yet. I get this big scary text down here in red, and everything here is in Chinese and I can't understand anything. So let's fix the first problem here. Let's at least get this text here in English. So how you do that is you go to your folder where you have all of your software, create a subfolder called languages, and then this English.ini, copy that to the clipboard, go into your languages folder and paste that English.ini file into that languages folder. Now when you run your ch341a.exe file, it uses that English INI file to populate the dialog. So everything is in English and I can at least read the content on here. And that big scary red message down there, device data not connected. This is simply because the drivers are not installed. It doesn't mean that the chip is not installed, but it just means the drivers aren't working. You'll notice as you dance this UI here, whether you pick a 24 or a 25 series, it actually has a graphic on that chip. This is actually in the improper location. So let's go ahead and install the drivers, and then we'll install the chip, and then you can read and write to your chip and stuff like that. So let's go ahead and close this dialog down and run this driver exe file. So what it's going to do is it's going to go to try here, install first to, oops, sorry, that's what happens when you don't have the chip plugged in. Let me plug it in first. I forgot I hadn't plugged it. And let's install the driver. And it's going to go to Windows and try to get the driver from Windows, which you don't want that. So skip obtaining driver from Windows and let it just install the software right from the small utility that came with the this download. Now that that is done, you get driver install success. You're pretty much home free at this point. If you have any problems, you might try to uninstall, make sure the chip, make sure that your reader-writer device is plugged into a USB port. You might even try it when it's not plugged in. It took me a few tries to get it to work right, but now that I have got it installed one time, I'm able to get this thing up and installed pretty easily. Now we can install, or now we can run our ch341ax.exe, and we have the device state. It's now connected. So as I may or may not have mentioned it earlier in the demo, I have a 24 type EEPROM from Microchip, and I am using a 24LC256 series, and it populates this table with a bunch of blank data, but it also has a graphic that is supposed to tell you how to install the chip. This graphic here is wrong. The video that you're watching right now shows the correct orientation with this small chip marker for pin 1 has to be hooked right or right next to the actual zero force lever. There's a small graphic on the actual printed circuit board that shows how to put this in, but just make sure you get it put in per the device itself and not the software. The software is wrong. If you try to plug it in wrong, like it shows here, it won't burn up your EEPROM, but this text here will go back to an unconnected state. It took me forever to figure out that it was actually going in wrong. I finally looked at the board and saw that it had the text printed on there like you see in the on the screen here. So make sure you get it in right and you'll be home free. Once that you have your EEPROM plugged in correctly, you can now read your EEPROM. You can program it, you can erase it, you can do all kinds of other fun things. But this is extremely easy to use at this point. You can even save the content of your EEPROM to a bin file or a hex file, and you can open it up and program another chip. So it's great for cloning EEPROMs. If you run into trouble and you want some help, hit the help button and you're kind of out of luck. They don't have any help with this thing, so you're really at the mercy of your own hacking abilities. If you hit the about button, it does tell you the version and stuff like that, but these links here are dead. They don't work. At least at the time of this video, these things didn't work, but hopefully if you've gotten to this point, you've probably got your drivers installed properly anyway. So this is not a lesson on how to program your controller, but I'm just going to put in some text here. I'm not going to really worry about what it is. You can have all kinds of fun typing in whatever data that you need to do, and you can write that to your chip. Or you can go to your data buffer, a little pull-down menu, hit the fill data buffer, and let's just type in, say, how about AA, and go from this offset 0 to 1111, and it populates all of that data with AA, whatever that value happens to be in hex. Once that you have that done, you can program your chip, and it actually writes the values from this table here right to your chip. Now, I actually don't have the chip plugged in. I just didn't feel like screwing up my one good left EEPROM. But once it's done, it would say the chip contents now match the table or something like that. There's a warning here because I don't have my chip plugged in. So what you can do is you can save this the content here so you can actually read the content of your chip if you had a chip plugged in, of course. And then you can save this to a file, and I'll just call this, how about FF. And you can open up that file or another file or anything. Maybe this is for if you want to clone EEPROMs. And then write that data. Oops, sorry, wrong one. You can write that data to your EEPROM. So if you want to clone the content of one EEPROM to another, you simply plug in an EEPROM. You read it, save it to a file, plug in your other EEPROM, open up that file and write it. So it's a pretty simple process to do. Again, like I said, I don't have a chip in here, but you get the idea on how all that would work. At any rate, that's all I have covered. Key things are is to get the right software and the right drivers, get them installed, And that little language trick that I showed you on how to get it to read an English.ini file to get the user interface in English, and just basically getting the chip in the right orientation using the graphics on the device and not the software. That's all I have. I hope you learned something. Thanks for watching.